So first up, we have a very cool panel, and it's chaired by a lovely lady who I've just met. And so I need to get her name right, which is always very important. So we've got Susan Agliata, who is the head of branded content for YouTube marketing solutions at Google. So I'd like to welcome her, and then she'll welcome the rest of the panel. Thank you very much.
Good afternoon, everyone. Actual name is Agliata, but that was a really good try. And actual title is even more complex. It's head of YouTube branded content at Google, but I'm based in London. I realize it's after lunch. This is a very tough slot, but we have some amazingly smart people here today, and we're going to be talking about video strategy. And I know the title of the panel is called the Holy Grail of video strategy. There is no Holy Grail, but what we will hear about is some actionable strategies to think about creating content that is impactful creatively, that is sustainable, and also measurable, of course. So I'd love to welcome to the stage, first, Eric Fulwiler from VaynerMedia, based in London. Thank you, Eric. And then we have Andrea Brown, head of content at Publicis in the UK. And then we have Jakob Stigler, who's joining us all the way from Copenhagen, who is from AOL Nordic. So thank you, guys. So the way we're going to do this panel is, first and foremost, please think about questions as we discuss that you want to ask. This panel is for you, first and foremost, so I do expect excellent, hard-hitting questions. And we're going to talk specifically about three case studies. And what I love about each of these case studies is that each one is different, each one has a very different approach, and each one had fantastic impact. So we're going to start with Eric. And if we can play the video first, unless you want to talk about it.
Yeah, I'll give a couple quick thoughts on it before we go into it. So, we're a digital advertising agency headquartered in the U.S. We opened up an office in London about a year ago, and our kind of whole approach is to try to be the best or one of the best companies in the world at creating video content, creating and distributing video content on the mobile device. So we spend a lot of time retooling the agency model, looking at talent, looking at ways of working to try to figure out how we can be more efficient and effective with the video content that we create. The case study I'm going to show you is some work that we've done with Budweiser in the US. So ABI, the parent company that owns Budweiser, has been a client of ours for a while. And this is a video that we made for them for the World Series of Baseball last October. And I know there's not baseball in this country or in Europe to a certain extent, but I've been told that sports can transcend cultures, so hopefully everybody will still get something out of it. So I'm gonna play it, and then I'll speak a little bit about the production model, specifically of how we approached it, how we sold it in, and then how we executed the video.
Sure as God made green apples, someday the Chicago Cubs are gonna be in a World Series, and maybe sooner than we think. Hello again, everybody. Harry Carey of Cleveland. It's such a pleasure to see you, especially on a noteworthy night indeed. The Cubs 3 outs away from winning. Boy, if you've got a weak heart, turn the set off.
Come on, boy.
The rest of you stay with us. The crowd quiet. Now ready. The pitch. Bouncing ball. There's a throw.
Cubs Cubs had not won the World Series for over 100 years. And the guy you saw at the beginning whose voice was announcing what was the final out of the last game was a guy who had died 20 years earlier. And so we went in and actually recut audio footage of him calling other games, because he was an announcer for the Cubs before that, and stitched it together over scenes of the Cubs actually winning the game. And so from a production standpoint, you know, Budweiser had actually come to us and asked us to do a TV spot, and we went back to them with this idea about 2 weeks before the game. And so I had to move very, very quickly to not only sell it in, but then actually get a crew to Chicago to be able to shoot this. So the speed was super important. We talk a lot about long-form emotional video, which kind of goes contrary to, you know, a lot of discussions that are happening around video needing to be shorter online. I think we're going to get into that a little bit later. But yeah, I mean, that approach worked for us. We had a crew there in Chicago who shot all that film overnight and then edited it and posted it at 8 a.m. the next day. So the speed of production is something that we think really matters a lot, too.
So what was the option B if they didn't win?
Yes. So option B if they didn't win is we actually produced a second spot with the other team in Cleveland, which is where they were from, in case they had won. So, you know, the term real-time marketing, I think, isn't quite as current or used as it was a few years ago, but this is real-time marketing. We call it culture hacking now, but it's not responsive real-time marketing, it's proactive real-time marketing. So we put a lot of thought and energy and time into thinking about what we would do depending on the situations that happened in cultural moments that were important to our audience.
And from a distribution perspective, what was your plan from the moment that the Cubs won the game? How were you going to get that out there?
Yeah, so all of that work had been done ahead of time, too. So the video was made specifically with Facebook and YouTube in mind. So it was made for mobile, primarily. All the work that we do, unless it's explicitly a TVC, is made with mobile in mind. And so we worked with the media agency to come up with a plan for how it would get distributed. The timeliness, again, was super important to us, and making sure that we got as much attention as possible with the dollars that we had to spend.
And Andrea, I know that you've done quite a bit of work in the real-time space as well, as close to real-time. And this is probably, from my perspective, one of the hottest topics and how we change our model to work more quickly and be more flexible. And I know you had some thoughts on that.
Yeah, I think, so we worked with Samson around the Rio Olympics, building a newsroom, so really doing what you guys did across the night, and I know how much work it is. It's a lot of work to do, but across the 2 weeks of the Olympics campaign, where Samson was an official sponsor, working slightly different models, sort of working with influencers who were Samson's own brand ambassadors, as well as working with media partners as well, and having a creative unit and plugging it straight into distribution. So curating and creating content, but then plugging it straight into digital distribution, same as what Eric is saying, built for social platforms first. And what that, it's that timeliness that really allows us to really grab the attention. So all of the Olympic sponsors did amazing work, but we outpaced in terms of engagement with the official brand, but two times by the next brand. So it is something, it's the timeliness and the freshness of the content that works. It doesn't, but you don't have to do that all the time. I don't know if there's many brands in the audience. It's only relevant around certain tentpole events. And I think that a lot of brands, to your point, we don't talk about real time anymore. You don't need to do it all the time. It's an unnecessary pressure on the business. It's not necessarily delivers the best results, but
yeah, it's just especially applicable to major sporting moments, big cultural moments.
Yeah.
You'll have that impact.
Yeah. Well, yeah. Exactly.
Thank you. So now we're going to move on to REI. And what I love about this case study is that it was actually telling people not to buy stuff. people did end up buying stuff. So I love it. So tell us more.
Well, this is, for those of you that don't know REI, they're an outdoors retailer in the US. They've been around since about 1938. They have an overarching brand purpose of a life lived outdoors is a life well lived. And this is a campaign that we're pretty proud of. It won the Titanium Award at Cannes last year. The video speaks for itself.
In the news tonight, another Black Friday has arrived.
Retailers opening their doors earlier
chaos
this year.
Chaos erupting when someone tried to cut
the parking lot. It was a chaotic scene.
taking a stand against the Black Friday frenzy. A major retailer is refusing to open on Black Friday this year.
REI. All of its locations will be closed on Black Friday.
And it won't be processing any sales online.
It will pay employees to take Black Friday off.
To spend time outdoors.
This is my first Black Friday off in 27 years.
This Black Friday, we're closing all 143 of our stores.
We'd rather be in the mountains than in the aisles. Join us on November 27th at Opting Outside.
Retailers are joining REI, deciding to close their doors on Black Friday.
So I'd love to understand two things. Mm-hmm. One, how did you convince REI that this was a good strategy? And two, how did you think about measuring success from the start, right? You're not driving sales with this, at least it seems like you're not. What did you want to measure from this campaign?
So I'm going to answer them in the reverse order. We wanted to get some cut through. We wanted to bring REI back to the kind of cultural heartland of what they stood for. The fact that, and Black Friday, even though it's the most important day for retailers in the, not just the US now, certainly in Britain, they wanted to do something was much more aligned with what they stood for as a brand. Because as you all know, it's impossible to get cut through around Black Friday. So the CEO is amazing. Jerry is incredible. And we have an amazing brand advocate, like in terms of an amazing advocate within the business, who she's their chief creative officer. She drives integration and she champions their ideas. And I think she really helped us to get it off the ground. And the measurement was initially just around engagement. How could we get people engaged and talking about REI in a new context, in a way that was true to who they were? You saw on the video, you know, it did, people were talking about it, but amazingly, it led to an uptick in sales, completely counterintuitively, because we kind of landed our message and it gave people a reason to think about going back outdoors. We didn't set out to measure it as a kind of sales, but in the end that kind of worked out. And it's led us to be able to springboard onto expanding out the platform to an up-and-coming campaign, which is hashtag Force of Nature, which is bringing women to the front and center of the outdoors. And I think it's the key thing about this is it's like, if you want to get cut through, you need to stand for something as a brand. And it's very, very hackneyed, but I think this is a brilliant example of how you can use video to connect emotionally, but it also is not at the expense of commercial success.
We tend to think campaign by campaign, right? And in this case, it's actually expanded. There's partnerships with other brands, Subaru, for example. Was that the intention from the start, or did it just organically develop into an always-on kind of long-term strategy?
What we've done is we've been able to make content we've proved the case for content being an effective way of driving business results with the Opt Outside campaign. We didn't explicitly have the long-term goal of like leapfrogging from campaign to campaign, but we had such a beautiful brand architecture that it has just naturally led us on to these ongoing campaigns and partnerships, which will continue to give people reasons not to buy the products, but to get outside, which so it's much more connected to a human need and sort of answering, you know, driving an emotional connection to the brand rather than just trying to sell stuff at, you know, 2-for-1 prices. So I think it's that, again, I'm going to say it again, but I think getting the cut through is, in that kind of space, is just, it's driven by having a purpose and just explaining that brand purpose to a range of audiences.